Hello everyone, let's start the hands-on section of the gRPC course. The target of the whole section is to build a PC book web service that will allow us to manage and search for laptop configurations. In this lecture, we will learn how to write a very simple protocol buffer message with some basic data types and how to write comments for them. We will also learn how to install Visual Studio Code plugins to work with Protobuf. And finally, we will install Protocol Buffer Compiler and write a makefile to run code generation for Go. But before start, make sure that you already have Go and Visual Studio Code up and running properly on your computer. If not, you can watch my tutorial video on how to install Go and set up Visual Studio Code. Link in the description. The tutorial will guide you step by step to install Go. Add the bin folder to your path, install Visual Studio Code, customize its theme, and set up Go extensions to work with it. Once everything is ready, you can come back here and continue this lecture. Alright, let's start by creating a new project. First, I will create a simple Hello World program in Go and run it, just to make sure that Go is working properly. Then, I'm going to create a new folder named Proto and add a processor message.proto file under it. Now VS Code is asking if we want to install extensions for the proto file or not. Yes, we do. So let's click Search Marketplace. There are two extensions shown at the top that we should install, the golang format and VS Code Proto 3. Okay, now come back to our proto file. This file will contain the message definition of the CPU of a laptop. We start with syntax equal proto 3. At the time I record this video, there are two versions of protocol buffer on Google's official documentation, proto 2 and proto 3. For simplicity, we will only use proto 3, the newer version in this course. Now, let's see how to define a message. The syntax is pretty simple. Just use the message keyword followed by the name of the message. Then inside the message block, we define all of its fields as shown in this picture. The name of the message should be upper camel case, and the name of the field should be lower snake case. There are many built-in scalar value data types that we can use. For instance, string, bool, byte, float or double, and many integer types. We can also use our own data types, such as enums or other messages. Each message field should be assigned a unique tag. And tag is more important than the field name, because Protobuf will use it to serialize a message. A tag is simply an arbitrary integer with the smallest value of 1 and the biggest value of 2 to the power of 29 minus 1. Except for numbers from 19,000 to 19,999, as they are reserved for internal protocol buffer implementation. Note that tags from 1 to 15 take only 1 byte to encode, while those from 16 to 2047 take 2 bytes. So you should use them wisely, like saving text from 1 to 15 for very frequently occurring fields. And remember that the tags don't need to be in order or sequential, but they must be unique for the same level fields of the message. Okay, so let's get back to our proto file and define the CPU message. The CPU will have a brand of type string, such as Intel, and a name also of type string, for example, Core i7-9850. We can write comment for each field like this, similar to comment in Go, or other ways similar to Java like this. It's super easy, so I don't want to waste time on writing comments in this course. But keep in mind that you should always write detailed comments when you work on a real project, because it will help your current and future teammates a lot. Alright, now we want to know how many cores or threads the CPU have. They cannot be negative, so let's use unsigned in 32 here. Next, it has the minimum and maximum frequency, for example 2.4 GHz or something like that. So it's safe to use float here. Or we can use double if we want. Okay, looks like we've finished our first protobuf message. Now, how can we generate Go code from it? First, we need to install protocol buffer compiler or protoc. On macOS, we can easily do that with the help of homebrew. Don't worry if you don't have homebrew installed. Just open your browser, search for it, then copy the install command on the side and run it in the terminal. Once homebrew is installed, we can go ahead to run brew install protobuf, and that's it. We can check if it's working or not by running the protoc command. Next, we will go to gRPC.io to copy and run two commands to install two Go libraries. First, the golang gRPC library. And second, the protoc gengo library. Now we are all set to generate Go codes. I will create a new folder named pb to store the generated Go codes. Then run this command. Our protofile is located inside the proto folder, so we tell protoc to look for it in that folder. With the goout parameter, we tell protoc to use the gRPC plugins to generate Go codes and store them inside the pb folder that we've created before. Now, if we open that folder in Visual Studio Code, we will see a new file, processor-message.pb.go. Look inside, there's a CPU struct and all fields with the correct data types as we defined in our protocol buffer file. There are some special fields used internally by gRPC to serialize the message, but we don't need to care about them. The bottom line is, some useful getter functions are also generated, so it looks great. However, the command that we use to generate code is pretty long, so it's not very convenient to type when we update the proto file and want to regenerate the code. Let's create a makefile with a short and simple command to do that. Add a gen task, then paste the code generation command under it. Also add a clean task to remove all generated Go files whenever we want. We can define the run task to run the main.go file as well. Okay, let's try them in the terminal. Make clean. The generated file is now deleted. Make gen. The file is regenerated in pb folder. And finally, make run. Hello world. Wow, it's been a long lecture. Thank you for watching. We still have a lot to discover, so stay tuned for the next one. Until then, happy coding!